Hey, good morning. I'm Professor James Sims from Quietstorm Dojo. This is another great interview from Sanukashu Skills and Drills and of course the Quietstorm Dojo. Today we have the Grandmaster Rick Berry, my original teacher, my Taekwondo Jido Kwon teacher, also my Aikido teacher. He's also the one who sent me to Dr. Moses Powell many years ago. And we're gonna just discuss his history, the dojo history, the history of the 70s and the martial arts, his transition from Jido Kwon Taekwondo into Aikido Kokikai. And we're gonna also talk about relationship with Dr. Moses Powell and how Dr. Moses Powell and he came together and produced what you see me doing here at the dojo. So, good morning, Professor. How are you?
Good morning. I'm doing great.
Now, you may hear me refer to him as Professor Berry, but it's Grandmaster Berry. In fact, you know, there's a lot of grandmasters out there. I respect them all. No problem. But some of them are 40 years old. Some of these grandmasters are 30 years old. Some of these grandmasters are just turning 50. Well, this young man right here has been my teacher since I was 9 years old. And he's 82 years old, pardon me, 82 years young right now. He can still do rollouts. He can still do spinning crescent kicks. He can still do all his katas. And he looks the way he did when I met him back in 1972. So, we're going to get a wealth of knowledge today, and this is an example of what the up-and-coming martial artist should aspire to become, a young man as you get older and wiser. So, Grandmaster Berry, tell us, how did you start your training in the martial arts, briefly?
Well, initially started in the military.
Yes, sir.
Martial is translated as military arts. So I was drafted into the U.S. Army, spent 2 years in Germany, and when I got out in 1965, I had seen examples of martial arts. I'd seen a lot of movies, and I just wanted to do something. My original intention was to just study for a couple of years.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to learn to protect myself. That's all I wanted. And I figured that as I got older, I could practice in my backyard or in my basement, whatever I was gonna end up having, you know, by the time I ended up having my own home. So my intention was just to spend just a couple of years learning a little self-defense, thinking that would be good enough.
Yes.
I didn't play basketball, I didn't play baseball, so I needed something to keep myself physically fit. I figured this would do it.
Yes, sir.
I never expected this thing to become a lifelong lesson.
Yes, sir. So tell us about your first instructor or your first class. How was that? How did that go?
Well, my first class wasn't in Taekwondo. It was in Seibokan Karate, Okinawan Shorinryu. That was in Holmes, Pennsylvania, right outside of Chester. The instructor there was Walter Daly, and my specific instructor in that system was Bill Davis.
Yes,
who became a lifelong friend of mine.
Yes, sir.
And I did that for about 3 months, and then I saw an article in the newspaper that a gentleman was going to be opening a karate class at the Central YMCA in Chester. Big write-up in the paper. I figured I'd go check it out. I talked to my buddy who worked at Reynolds, Ronald Phillips, and I said, we went in and checked the class out. Well, it turned out not to be a class. It turned out to be a question and answer period, and the gentleman was showing 8-track movies of what the training was like in the Korean system. And I saw a video of his teacher, CK Kim, jumping up and touching the net of a basketball on a basketball rim. I was shocked, and I had heard some fantastic things about the martial arts, but when I saw that, okay, I got to train with this guy.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So you said something, and I'm going to come back to it later on in the interview. You said that you saw an advertisement for a karate class.
Yes.
But it turned out to be, in fact, judoquan taekwondo.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't understand how some of the Koreans who were from Korea and had taekwondo background and were trained in taekwondo, when they came to America, they advertised as a karate school. But we'll get into that when we talk about the lineage and the history and things of that nature.
Sure.
Okay. So, okay. So, you joined this class. What kind of student were you?
Kind of reluctant at first, because that first class that we supposedly had, like I said, turned out to be films and videos and questions, and the instructor's name was Steve McKnight. He said, we're going to start this class next week. Mm-hmm. That next week, he said, show up. All these people signed up, me included, showed up that next week to start training, and surprise, surprise, the YMCA put us in the basement. We had to clean a whole room full of junk and stuff that had been stored down there. We had to clean all this stuff out of this room, which took about an hour, and there were 60 of us. Cleaned all that out, then we had to sweep the floor, then we had to mop the floor, and then we had the class.
So that's old school training.
Yes, yes.
So yes. 60 of you joined up that particular time?
60 of us that first class.
Okay, so tell us about the training, some of the drills, briefly, and what type of student you were in that class.
Well, having been in the military, I had determination.
Yes, sir.
And he started putting us through it, but he made the statement right off the bat. He said, look, he said, there's 60 students, this is too many. It's too many. He said, I gotta cut this class down. So he deliberately made the training twice as hard as he normally would, as he put it. And we're in kibodachi stance, or sagosei in the Korean system. We're in that stance and practicing basic punches. We're going up and down the floor, practicing kicks and punches. And I was determined that I was gonna last. After being in basic training, I could handle anything. At least that's what I thought.
So how long did they have you stand in sagosei stance or kibodachi?
Sometimes 10 minutes, sometimes 15 minutes. Mm. And as he's going around making the corrections on the position of the punches and all that, looking all over the place, you know, he turns his back and your legs are starting to tremble. You know, you start standing back up, getting the pressure off your legs.
Right.
I mean, this is hard training. And he turned back around to catch people standing up instead of being down in that kibodachi stance. He said, get down or get out.
Mm. So that's where you got that from. But now you said you all were in the horse stands for 15 minutes. You had us in horse stands for 30 minutes. Well, how did that happen?
Well, there's an old adage, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
Yes, sir.
So what I got is what I gave.
Yes, sir.
It changed me. It changed the people in that room training. We trained twice a week, and 2 days, in addition to those 2 days in training session, I spent in my backyard training.
Yes, sir.
Because I couldn't get enough of this stuff.
Right.
And I mean, it was time to go, time to do. He put us in those stances. We might be in the front leaning rest position. That's what you call it in the military, on our knuckles doing push-ups. And he wanted your back ramrod straight. And there's some people, you know, the back would start to sag and.
Yes, sir.
Get the position and get out. Go down, touch your chest to the floor, but don't lay on the floor. Get back up, up on your knuckles.
Yes, sir.
Oh, and this was a concrete floor.
Yes, sir. Like the one we had in our dojo, right?
Yes, concrete floor.
So basically, he was doing a process of elimination to get rid of the weak links in the class so
yes.
he can have a strong dojo.
Yes.
Okay.
In 2 weeks, the class was cut in half.
Got you. Makes sense.
Down the
I've seen it happen. So let me ask you this. So Sensei McKnight was your teacher, but he had a grandmaster, Grandmaster C.K. Kim, who was known in New York City as the Deadly Gentleman. In fact, he graced the cover of martial arts magazines doing a flying sidekick.
Right.
We want to get into his history and his lineage, but I want to go into the story of how you became one of the top students and eventually wound up becoming the instructor of that class, and how the dojo was turned over to you by Grandmaster Kim and Sensei McKnight.
Well, there's one little point that's missing. McKnight had studied at the University of North Carolina, down in North Carolina, and he trained under Kim's number one student, Tan Yun.
Yes, sir.
So Tan Yun was teaching in North Carolina. Kim was teaching in New York City.
Yes, sir.
So my first contacts were only with Mr. Yun.
Yes, sir.
And he would come up for belt exams and teach us and train us and promotions, the whole nine yards. He put us through it. So the first half of my career studying with Steve McKnight was studying under Tan Yun.
Yes, sir.
He was real short. He's only about this tall.
Wow.
But he was a tough taskmaster, so I saw where McKnight got his training and the drive that he put on.
Yes, sir.
He brought a 14-year-old student up with him, and the student was wearing a white belt. And he asked McKnight, he said, where's your seventh ranked student? And McKnight pointed to me, 7Q.
Yes, sir.
Yellow belt. And McKnight pointed to me and had me go out there to spar this young man. Well, this guy had a brand new, white, clean, spotless uniform. White belt, everything was sparkling, brand new. And all the students knew that I was, as they told me now, I was the toughest fighter and the fastest fighter there in the training, because I had 3 months on these guys from studying Shore and Root.
Right.
They had me spar this 14-year-old kid. Of course, now he was a kid, but he was about my size. He was big for that, for his age. No sooner, Yun said, fighting stance, bow to each other, bow to me, ready, begin. And no sooner did he said begin, that 14-year-old boy's foot was in my stomach. Damn, this guy's fast. And I sparred him. I fought him. And this was just the preliminary class in the afternoon because the belt exam was going to be that night.
Yes, sir.
Couldn't deal with this guy. I mean, this kid could fight. And I'm saying, man, oh, man. Studying under Asians must really be awesome because this is a 14-year-old kid. He's wearing a white belt, and I can't handle him. I'm a yellow belt. I can't handle him.
Right.
After the class was over, sent us home. Come back at 7:00. We're going to have the belt exam. Came back that night. Said, I know what's going to happen. They put us through all kinds of drills, all kinds of trainings. I know what's going to happen. You can put me on this 14-year-old boy kid here. Nice, interesting test.
Mm-hmm.
Sure enough, that's what he did. Now, again, bow to each other, bow to the instructor, fighting stance, begin. I'm ready for this kick. No sooner he said begin, there was the foot. I hit it, I blocked it, it still got through. Come to find out, after everything was over, all the dust settled, everything, this boy was a purple belt. But he didn't have a uniform when they decided they're going to come up there. So they grabbed a brand new uniform and put it on him and brought him on up. And that was the one of the big lessons that McKnight had been drilling into us all the time I've been training. You don't fight the belt, you fight the man.
Bush. Yes, sir. That's
and
right.
That lesson never left me.
Wow.
So now you said, have I ended up taking over?
Yeah. Tell us how you got to become the instructor of that class and how Grandmaster Kim got involved.
Well, McKnight, he wouldn't let any students start in individually. He would wait and get a sign-up list, 10, 12 people, and then he'd bring them all in as a group. Mm-hmm. And by that time, like I said, the class was down to half, and even that was starting to dwindle a little bit more. So he just threw it on me, said, Mr. Barry, and he called everybody Mr. Everybody was Mr. This, Mr. That. Mr. Barry, take these beginners, take them over there in the corner, and teach them how to do a front kick. So went over, start working with them. And I'm thinking, man, I really don't want to do this. I want to train, man. I want to. And he put me over there working with these beginners. I'm working with them, working with them, working with them. And that second group, that was the second group that came in. That second group, none of them lasted.
Well, you were too hard on them then.
Well, yeah, because that's what Mr. McKnight told me. Said, Mr. Barry said, you got to ease up on these students a little bit. You're costing me students. But there was a hint of admiration in his voice that I kind of detected. Said he liked the idea that I was doing it. And see, the thing is, whatever you put somebody through, you went through it all with them.
Yes, sir.
You don't stand up there like a god up on the top of the steps and call out commands and they just do all kinds of stuff. You're going through everything that you're putting them through.
Yes, sir.
So that told me that he was proud of what I was doing, that I was moving in the right direction.
Yes, sir. So let's go into how you became the instructor, the head instructor. The school was turned over to you according to the history. So how did that happen?
Well, he was a Crozier Seminary student. That's the same seminary Martin Luther King went to.
Right.
And he was about to graduate. Mm-hmm. And he came up and told me, said, look, said, I'm getting ready to leave, but I don't want to lose this school. I want to keep this thing going. Said, I'm going to have Mr. Kim come down, talk to you. We work some things out. He'll come down about once a month and continue to teach. Said, but I'm going to give you a few pointers here on how to do this and how to do that. So he started paying close attention to me, started teaching me how to teach.
Yes, sir.
Teaching me how to teach. Matter of fact, he gave me a lesson. I was still brown belt then. Of course, you know, we didn't wear brown, we wore red.
Belt. Yes, sir.
Said, you go to George Dillman's tournament. Said, I'm not going to go. You go to George Dillman's tournament, and you take a bunch of the students up there, but you're going to wear my black belt as if you're a black belt. You wear that belt, and you go into the tournament. Okay.
To fight as a black belt?
Everything is a black belt. Said, as far as they're concerned, you're a black belt, you're a first stand.
Okay.
Got out there, got the training. I mean, got to putting, you know, going through stuff. Well, you naturally, you know, they start with the lower belts, work all the way right up and everything. Right. So there was a guy named Heidi Oshii from Binghamton, New York. There was a lot of Korean students, a lot of Korean instructors at this tournament. He told me, came up to me, said, you're black belt. Said, I got to run the brown belts, the fighting and kata. Said, these Koreans, since he put, Dillman put me in charge of this ring, said, these Koreans are not going to be side judges under me because they don't like the Japanese.
Right.
Said, how about helping me out be a judge with me in the brown belts? No problem. Okay, I'm thinking, so kata started first, naturally, right? They're going through the katas. And I'm thinking, darn. McKnight gave me drills and a lot of skills and everything, working with, you know, how to judge a kata, how to gauge a kata, the whole 9 yards. So, man, I'm really glad he did this for me, because now I'm sitting there and I have to judge and grade these brown belts, mm-hmm, this kata. So I'm thinking, I said, well, never did this in a tournament before, so I'll see what the other guys call, you know, for their points, and I'll call somewhere in that range.
Right.
Heidi Oshii put a little thing on me. I don't know whether he knew he was doing it or what, but all I know was it didn't work out like I thought. Because, you know, they're thinking they're gonna call each judge,
right,
and, you know, call, you know, put your hands up, you know, what the grades, what the score is gonna be. I think there were 10 competitors. Out of those 10 competitors for kata, he called me first.
So you had to give your score
first. My score, there was only two times that he did not call me first. Mm-hmm. But eight times he called me first. And then when it was, eight times he called me first. And I'm thinking, wow, so I gave my scores. Fives, sixes. I think I gave one seven, but all mostly all fives and sixes. The interesting thing was my score, you know, they give half points and stuff too. I think interesting thing was that all these guys, all these big time black belts are out there grading these brown belts because it was four corners in him. Mm-hmm. I was about a half a point under what they were calling.
Right.
So you know, I felt pretty good about myself that I gave pretty good scores.
Right. I remember when we used to have pretest at the dojo, all the masters would be sitting at the table and we would come out and do our form and they would give sevens and eights and then you would give a five. And everybody was like, man, this guy is tough. He doesn't give a high score. But that made the competitor raise their game high.
Yes. Okay. And see, now I didn't, you know, in the tournament, I don't know all these katas.
Right.
But what I was grading them on was their rhythm, their timing, what kind of balance they maintained, their eye contact when they were looking at their opponent. That's what I scored them on.
Yes, sir.
Since I didn't know the katas.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. So let's go into Grandmaster Kim. And you going from red belt to an official black belt, and you becoming the instructor.
I was testing for first Q, the highest rank brown belt.
Yes, sir.
Kim came down.
We're talking about Grandmaster.
Grandmaster Kim came down, and we had a class. That night we're gonna have the test. He put me through everything. He made me go through all the katas in the class. Every kata made me go through all of them. Mm-hmm. Critiquing. Then he had me spar, fighting all kinds of stuff. He's on me. Put me down in kibudachi stance, see how long I can handle it. Then he came and said, come on out there. He got out there on the floor with me. I got in a fighting stance. I think I was in left foot forward. He said, defend yourself. He said, I'm going to show this thing. I forget exactly how to explain it because this is 50 years ago.
Yes.
I'm in the fighting stance. He jumped, hit my left leg as if to sweep my leg, and while his foot was in the air on that left leg, switched in the air and threw a roundhouse kick, and his ball of his foot was in my temple. It hit me up, staggered back, shook my head, jeez. And I'm telling you all this, what these techniques were, but it took a while for me to figure out over time what it was that he hit me with.
Right.
Because
right.
At that time, I didn't know. All I knew was I was hit.
He was hit.
wasn't any such thing as trying to block it, but bam, bam. I'm woozy, staggering. Let's go sit in the corner. Went over and sat in the corner. He started putting other people through stuff. Thinking about this thing. Actually, that didn't take place in the class. That took place the night of the test.
Yes. So what happened?
They wouldn't give us the ranks, give us the scores on all the people testing. Mm-hmm. I was the highest ranked student there, and they start with the lowest rank and work all the way up. After the class was over, after the test was over, Mr. McKnight talked to us, Grandmaster Kim talked to us. So okay, McKnight said, come around to my house tomorrow morning. That was Saturday night. Come around to my house tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. No, make it 10 a.m. 10 a.m. I lived immediate that time. Came down, went over to visit my father, and then went over to McKnight's house. And it was a beautiful sunshiny morning, nice and comfortable. It was really nice. The sun was glittering. And McKnight came out and he's got all his papers and everything. And he's got a bunch of belts, but it's in a box. Mm-hmm. He started with the lowest student. No, first he said, No, he started giving out the lowest ranks. So-and-so made this rank, gave him the belt. Next person. So-and-so made this, got this rank, got this thing, gave him the belt. And like I said, I think it was about 10 or 12 of us, something like that. Up the line, up the line, up the line, up the line. And I'm waving to him. He said he got all the way up to, got to the last one. Brown belt. That was Larry Bachani. Mm-hmm. Presented him with his brown belt. And then he sat back and said, all the students that tested last night got the promotion that they were striving for, except one.
And you're the only one left.
I'm the only one left.
You wanted to cry, huh?
No, I didn't want to cry, but I was devastated. I had skipped the first rank at the bottom on the way up, and after that, I was one step at a time, one step at a time, one step at a time, one step at a time. Darn, I got all the way through this the first queue and failed a test because he said everybody got the rank that they were testing for except one. I'm just doing this, looking at this. How am I going to tell my father I failed a test?
Right.
And then Midnight continued talking. But he did get the rank of first degree black belt. You know how you're in a movie and you're watching the movie and something really traumatic or dramatic happens?
Mm-hmm.
The scene does this.
Mm-hmm.
That's what everything did. The room, we were outside, the students were doing this, the sky was doing this vibrant. I was devastated. All I could do was just say I was in shock.
Mm-hmm.
All the students came up, congratulate me, pat me on the back, shaking my hand. I was messed up. I mean, messed up. And McKnight said, Mr. Kim surprised us with this, but I failed to get a black belt for you. So I'm giving you my belt. Mm. So he gave me his belt.
So it was Grandmaster Kim's idea to skip you to black belt and
it was both of them, but Kim didn't bring any belts down. The right. Knight had gotcha, to get your belts.
Gotcha.
But,
okay, so now you're a black belt. Your teacher is leaving to go do what he went to college for. Grandmaster Kim approves you as the instructor, and you get the dojo. So I'm a fast forward a little bit because time is running out. So now you become the instructor. How did you come into this Quiet Storm Dojo? How did you become one of the most successful martial arts instructors and have one of the most successful dojos in the Delaware Valley? And how did you develop your own Taekwondo system? And how did that happen with Grandmaster Kim and you being in a position where you had to go out on your own?
Well, Mr. Kim was coming down. He told me to tell any, if I go to tournaments or anything and do any advertising and encounter any Koreans, said, let them know far and wide that I come down to teach you guys once a month.
Mm-hmm.
Let that be known. So that'll keep all the Koreans out of the city of Chester.
Mm.
No Korean is going to come into the city of Chester once that word's out that I'm teaching this school down here.
Yes,
said it's your school, but I'm coming down to train you once a month.
Yes, sir.
Well, it turned out that it wasn't once a month. He come down maybe every 3 months or so, mm-hmm. something like that, every 4 months. He come down, do the belt exam, and go back. Said I'll go back and I'll tabulate everything and compare what's going on in North Carolina, what's going on in New York City, and see what the rank should be, and then send you the results of the belt of the rank of the mm-hmm. test. And each time he'd go back, he would take longer to send the results back. And it got to a point where one time they had a belt exam, he went back, and by the time he sent the results back, some of the students had quit. It was sometimes 2 months before he sent the results back. Mm-hmm. That's what ended up happening. I assume he's too busy, you know, he's doing all kinds of stuff. Excuse me. So I wrote him a letter and asked him if it was okay for me to conduct the belt exam, and then when he comes down, either approve it or disapprove it, right. And then I could give the belts out when he's there, right after he leaves.
So, in other words, you were losing students because they would take a test, let's say in January, and they wouldn't have a result by April or May.
Yes, yeah.
So you wrote him a letter and requested permission to do the belt exam, but he still had to find himself.
Yes, he had to come down
whatever
to approve
you,
it. Yes,
yeah. Okay, so approve what happened?
So he never answered. So my thinking was, what he's telling me by his silence is, well, if you think you're that good and you're able to handle that thing, let's consider you to be independent. You're out on your own, see what happens. And I never heard from him again until Dave Rashan was up there going to law school and studying with him,
right.
And told him he was having an exam, and that's when we went up,
right.
And that's when he saw me again. He didn't see me till then.
Right. I understand. Okay.
That was 15 years later.
Okay. So, we're gonna... Okay. So, Grandmaster Kim comes down from New York City, and he's known all over the country. He's on the cover of magazines. Did he do a demonstration at Aaron Banks on Oriental Wall of Self-Defense? Or was that a tournament?
It was a championship. It was a tournament. He did a demonstration.
Okay.
He didn't do that with the Oriental thing of martial arts.
So, briefly tell us about Grandmaster Kim, what type of grandmaster he was, give us his history from Korea, who his teacher was, and just sum that up for us so the listening audience will know who Grandmaster Kim is.
When the Korean War was going on, the North Koreans invaded South Korea. Kim's father was a famous doctor, and when the North Koreans invaded and got pushed back by the American forces, they grabbed all the dignitaries and all the big shots that they could and took them back with him. So Kim lost his father and never saw him again. And he was a young kid. And the Grand Master of Jita Kwan, Chung Wu Lee, liked him and took him under his wing and started working with him personally and training him and teaching him. He was black belt at 14 years old. Mm-hmm. And in 1958, he was national champion of South Korea.
Yes, sir. Okay. So when he came to America, what was his attitude? What was his personality as far as the martial arts that he saw here?
Well, he didn't like show-offs. He didn't like people walking around with stripes on their belts and all that. Matter of fact, he told me, he said, if you want to put your rank out on display, said, get a piece of black cloth and put it on the lapel of your gi and put the rank there. And most people won't know what that is. They'll think that's just some kind of a symbol. He hated show-offs.
Right.
He was asked to judge a tournament. I was sitting there, and he wouldn't do it. He said, no, I'm not. He didn't say anything to them. They called him to be the chief referee for the grand championship in the match. And he didn't move. He was sitting with his arms folded like this. I was sitting right beside him. And they called his name, and the announcer was sitting right across the ring from him, and he called his name, and he didn't move and didn't budge.
Mm.
Never acknowledged them calling him.
Wow.
They ended up going to somebody else, but that's the way Kim was.
Yes, sir. Okay, so now you're on your own. He set you up to be on your own, and you started the Quiet Storm Dojo. Briefly tell us some of the stories of the 70s, how it was, some of the fights you had, some of the challenges. In the 70s, I was there with you. People would come to the dojo and challenge the dojo. And this was happening all over America, but we're from the city of Chester, which is 20 minutes from Philadelphia. Camden, New Jersey, and Chester have always been like the number one and number two depressed cities in the nation. So it's nothing but hardcore stuff going on. And you can get from Camden to Philly in 10 to 15 minutes. You can get from Chester to Philly in 20 minutes. So you came up in an era where there was a gang called Murder's Row.
Yeah.
Your brother-in-law, who married your sister, was the head of the Murder's Row. One of the captains in the nation, Captain Milton X. Belgrades, was part of it. Is that how you were able to handle the challenges that came to the dojo, because you came through that Murder's Row era?
Well, basically, it wasn't a gang, but that was the neighborhood, that was area, and he called it Murder's Row. It wasn't an organized gang, per se. Because, you know, the guys get into fights, somebody come from another part of town, and get in a fight with a guy. Or these guys from Murder's Row couldn't go to those neighborhoods. That's
yes,
what
sir.
That was.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But I didn't have any problems with them, I guess, because I knew a lot of the guys, so I never had any problems. And the fact that I was in a singing group, and it was different guys, some of our singing group members were from all different parts of Chester, so it was like we had a safe conduct pass or a passport, so we could go to all different parts of the city of Chester right. And never have a problem, wouldn't be run home or anything.
Okay, we'll talk about your singing later. We want to get into the dojo history. So just tell us some of the few things that happened in the dojo, challenges, some of the people you fought, and some of your toughest moments.
Well, some of the toughest moments were a guy named Bob Godwin used to come up from Wilmington, spar him and the whole school that he was training in. I forget the guy's name that was the head of the dojo there. I can't remember his name, but his school used to come up. We spar. Now we had nice understanding with these guys. We had some nice fights and some nice scraps and everything worked. There was no problems there, but it's still hard fights. Jock Taylor would come up from Wilmington, Delaware, and we'd spar and have a whole lot of stuff going on. That's how I got to know Benny Young.
Yes, sir. Okay. Okay.
But those are some tough fights. But we had a couple guys that come in and walk in the door and with the attitude that they want to challenge somebody, because that used to happen. Guys were known to walk into somebody's dojo and challenge them to a fight. Guys would walk in and see them standing at the doorway, and you can see them chanting at the bit. Man, I'm looking at these guys. Might be three or four of them standing there watching. Not too respectful, just glaring.
Right.
As soon as I see that look, I just grab any two students. I might grab two kids or two adults or even two females. Have them face each other, bow to me, bow to each other, fighting stance, begin. And I walk off the floor. And those people, my students could fight. I mean, fight. And by the time the fight was over, the guys were standing in the door preparing to challenge somebody. You could see their mouths dropping open. And they would turn around and walk on out the door. No challengers coming in like that.
Yes, sir.
Matter of fact, after a while, I started hearing rumors. Some of our students were trained and traveled all over the city of Chester. They come back and they tell me, Mr. Barry, you know what people say? People say, Quiet Storm, and the guys in Quiet Storm, they don't spar, they fight for real in there.
Yes, sir. That's
so right. We weren't fighting for real, but it was get-down time.
Yes, sir.
And there were tile floor, tile on concrete, and we'd sweep each other and all kinds of stuff. I mean, it was scrap time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I know. They don't know. Okay. So, real quick, I'll tell the story. Yes, you're a martial artist. Yes, you're a long history of martial arts. Jeet Kune, Taekwondo, of course, you walked away from Taekwondo and went into Kokikai Aikido, and now you hold the rank of 7th Dan and have one of the most successful dojos in this large system ran by Japanese. But before you left Taekwondo, you had developed friendships with some of the top masters in Philadelphia and the Delaware Valley. Grandmaster S.L. Martin, Grandmaster Pat Burns, Grandmaster Ozzie Wright, Grandmaster Thornton from the Iron Cobras from Camden, Grandmaster J.C., who they used to call Jesus Christ, which used to really blow my mind when I was younger, Grandmaster Fred Scott, you and Grandmaster T. Rondo Van Cleef are like best friends and talk all the time, and You know all these people. You've done tournaments. You were a singer in the singing group. You and Grandmaster S.L. Martin and Grandmaster Pat Burns in the 70s developed a federation called Umara, which is still thriving today, which teaches black belts and masters how to conduct themselves on and off the mat, how to conduct yourself at a tournament, how to properly score and judge fights, how to properly do kata. In fact, I believe this is the plaque right here. Umara Grand Nationals Karate Championship. The three founders, Master Rick Barry, Master Pat Burns, and Master S.L. Martin. You've accomplished a lot. You had a fight one time with a champion, a tough fighter by the name of, I believe it's Master Malachi Lee. Tell us about that.
Oh, that was the tournament that Mr. McKnight sent me to as a brown belt, masquerading as a black belt. George Dillman's tournament in Reading. And he sent me out there to the tournament. And I'm watching this guy, Malachi Lee, 6'8". I think he was second. I know it was second dan, but I thought he might have been third dan. Mm-hmm. It was either second or third. But anyhow, I watched his fights. There was 18 black belts, counting me. And the first fight that he had, Malachi Lee had, the guy ran from him for the entire 2 minutes, then a minute overtime.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, man, that's totally disrespecting a man's belt rank to do that.
Right.
And after the dust was settled, there was five people for the finals. Said, we got to get rid of one, so we're going to have a fight off. And they threw a bunch of cards out there. Everybody grab a card. I grabbed one. All the guys grabbed one. And I grabbed one with the X on it. Malachi Lee grabbed one with the X on it. So he and I had to fight to get into the finals.
How tall was he?
6'8".
And you're 5'8", 5'9".
Yeah.
Okay.
So, well, right off the bat, I made darn sure I'm not going to disrespect my instructor's belt, because it's his belt that I'm wearing.
Right.
By running from this guy, I stood and fought the guy.
So you were a brown belt, but you were masquerading as a black belt.
Yeah.
And you're fighting a 6'8" Malachi Lee.
First thing, he threw a side kick at my head. I got my shoulder, blocked the kick with my shoulder. He knocked me 5 feet through the air. I went over the scorekeeper.
Mm-hmm.
Got up, dusted myself off, went back in there and fought. And we fought. We had to go into overtime before he finally caught me with a roundhouse kick to the forehead.
Yes, sir.
So he won. So he was in the finals. I was out.
Okay. So you were part of the era of, and there were no headgear, no handgear, none of that. Maybe a cup. That was it.
Yeah.
Bare knuckles. Yes, sir. All right. So you walked away from Taekwondo. Just tell us what happened.
The students wanted to, they loved fighting. They didn't like kata so much. They liked fighting. They wanted to fight. They wanted to spar. But it wasn't so much the students that I walked away from. It was the whole tournament scene in karate. These instructors were not teaching their black belt students proper respect and courtesy. Guys were getting into fights, all kinds of junk. They're challenging the instructor, the referees and all kinds of junk. And I said, I'm tired of this thing. And that's when me, Pat Burns, and SL were complaining about it. We decided to do something about it and start Umara to teach young black belts how to judge a kata.
Yes, sir.
So the arguments and fights wouldn't break up. But by that time, it was too late. I was tired of this thing. And so I said, I'm fed up with the tournament scene. I'm fed up with disrespect. So I'm going someplace where I don't have to worry about competition at all. So I went and decided to go into Aikido. So when I decided to make that move, and I had been studying Aikido at that time for about a year and a half,
yes,
and I told my number one student, Mr. Nichols, I turned the school over to him, said, you got the school, I'm out, I'm going into Aikido full time. And that's what I did. I walked away.
So who's the grandmaster of the system of Aikido that you teach in?
That's Shuju Maruyama Sensei.
Give us a brief history of him. Who was his teacher? How did he develop this system?
He studied under Tohei, who was the chief instructor of Aikido Aikikai.
Yes, sir.
He was if not one of the first students of Ueshiba, he was way up there near the top.
Yes,
he was
sir.
The chief instructor, and Maruyama Sensei was his student. And after Ueshiba died, his son took over, and the ranking, the people underneath of him, didn't like the idea that Tohei was using this thing called ki development. They wanted to be strictly Aikido. They didn't like that idea of ki development. So when that happened, he resigned. And Maruyama Sensei was still with him, but then Maruyama Sensei decided to resign from him and start his own system.
Mm-hmm.
So it got to be called Kokikai.
How many? So he's in Japan.
Yes.
And he comes to America how many times?
Three times a year.
Okay. Yeah. And how many members are in this Kokikai Federation that you're in?
Well, the biggest group is the United States, because this is where he actually started the system in the United States.
Right. How many members you think are here overall? Give me a number.
Well, in the camps, there'd be about maybe 250 people come to a camp, training camp.
To a seminar.
To a seminar, yeah.
Okay. But that's on the East Coast, but they have stuff on the West Coast,
yeah.
And it's the same number.
Yes.
So it's at least 1,000 or 2,000 members?
At least.
Okay. Let me ask you this. This is a Japanese man. Now, you started off with a grandmaster from Korea, and you're in the Korean system, but you're a black man in a depressed city, and you have a successful dojo. Now, you're under a Japanese man from Japan who has a successful Aikido system in America and Japan, and you're now an instructor. In fact, you had two dojos, one in Swarthmore, Pennsylvania, one here in Wilmington, Delaware.
Yes.
Kokikai Wilmington. And you're what right now?
Seventh Dan.
You're seventh Dan in the Japanese system. Now, there are pictures in this dojo. I'll somehow connect them to this interview. And it appears to be 99% Caucasians in this Japanese system.
Yes.
But you happen to be a black man from one of the depressed cities in America, had your own system in Taekwondo, now you are seventh dan in the system. So when you guys line up, I'm looking at the picture and I see certain top masters that line up next to the founder of the system. But when I look at the picture, I see you like maybe three steps from him. How do you do that? How does that work? You have 90% Caucasian students and you're a black man. Explain that.
I can't explain that. All I know is when I'm on the mat, all I see is individual people. And I teach that way. Matter of fact, teaching Taekwondo in the city of Chester, I had 30% of my class was white students,
mm-hmm.
down on Third Street,
mm-hmm.
a depressed, predominantly black city. And some of those Caucasian students, parents, they would all drop them off because I didn't want them to sit there and watch the training. And they come back to pick them up, they'd be late coming back to pick them up.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm not gonna stand there and babysit them, so I locked the door and leave those students standing out there on Third Street and going about my business. There were black guys walking back and forth. Nobody ever bothered those guys. Everybody in the city knew who those guys were because the training facility they were standing outside of, nobody ever bothered them.
Yes, sir.
When I was going to tournaments, because I was starting under Big Nice class, I had 80% black, white students at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So the thing was always mixed. So first of all, race doesn't come up when I train, every
right.
place I go. It doesn't
right.
come up.
Right.
It's just, the thing I do is I just think in terms of how do you best handle yourself and how do you make the world better? My intention is, as I train, to make the world a better place. So put it this way, I no longer practice Aikido as a means of self-defense. I practice it as a means of self-improvement. And as I improve my environment, that makes me safer.
Yes, sir. Which is self-defense.
Which is self-defense.
Got you. Speaking of that, I almost forgot. Let's go back to Judicorn. You're a master in Taekwondo, and you have a lot of students, great fighters, great fighters. I've seen you get your jaw broke, your arm broke. I've seen your finger get broke. I got my nose busted, bloody everywhere. My white gi turned red. I've seen all kind of stuff. And one of the things about our dojo, we always produce the toughest women. In fact, we don't even call them women. We call them warriors. And Grandmaster Kim was very impressed with all of the women in that class. And he was really impressed with your then top student, Master Bill Gross, because they fought one time. Yeah. He said, man, this guy is tough. But as time went on, there's a young lady who I grew up with. I went to school with her. In fact, we even graduated from school together. And she came in, she's the niece of your top student. And she comes into the dojo and starts training with you. Time goes on, I mean, she could fight. Time goes on, she goes out and becomes a world champion kickboxer. And this is Inside Karate Magazine, if you all can see. I'll bring it closer. Inside Karate Magazine. And here's this young lady who went out and became a kickboxing champion. Several championships. And she also was a boxer. And on the front page of this magazine at the top, it says, meet the world's deadliest woman. And inside she has a 4-page article. She became the champion of the world. Her name is Frida Gibbs. We went to high school together. We came up together from the same dojo, taught by the same master. She was in a few movies. She was on The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. They just did a documentary about her life called The Deadliest Woman in the World. And one of my students, Naisia Muhammad, played her as a young girl right here in this dojo. One of the accomplishments of a great master, when you can reproduce yourself, that's, in my opinion, the sign of a great master. And he's humble. I'm telling the story because he won't. That's one accomplishment. He's also, I told you, he was a singer. He had his own singing group. And in the 60s, was it?
Late 60s, early 70s.
He was so into that, they produced a record. It was played on two records, and it was played on the radio stations and everything. And then he's in magazines about his singing. He also, when he was in the Murder's Row neighborhood, he was known as a pool shark. Nobody could deal with him on a pool table. In fact, he was so good that he wouldn't even play for money. And then when he started playing for money, it became like work to him, so he stopped playing. But today, he can whoop just about anybody on the pool table the same way he whooped people in the dojo. But not only was he a singer and a pool shark, he also is an author. He has a book entitled Stepping Off the Mat. You might want to get this. He was also on the front page of the local newspaper, right here at the dojo. They did a big article on him. So we're talking about somebody who's respected in the community, respected in the dojo, professional, loving, and humble, and has accomplished so much. He's also the founder of a martial arts federation. And he's also the man who sent me to Moses Powell. And Dr. Moses Powell was so impressed with the fact that a man who has his own system and is successful would send one of his top students to train with him, because that's unheard of. It's unheard of. And then my loyalty to him, in fact, I'm still with him. I teach at the same dojo that he teaches at. We share this. Doc was so impressed with my loyalty to him that Doc came down here and had seminars, taught classes, promoted him in Sun Lucas, gave him this beautiful plaque you see here, and then there's another plaque up top, really beautiful. I'll show it to you later. So it gives me great pleasure and honor to share with you all the history of my teacher, my friend, my father. Like I said, I've been with him since I was 9 years old. You want to talk about longevity? You want to talk about being dedicated and loyal to your teacher? When you see me, you see him. So I wanted to just share with you some of his story. We may have to do this again because I also want to show you him on the mat at 82 years old, flying rollouts, spinning crescent kicks, kata, full power, techniques, defending, and his teaching skill is very high. So before we leave, I just want to ask you this, sir. What advice do you have for up-and-coming martial artists? What advice do you have for the martial arts students? And what advice do you have for instructors of martial arts today?
For instructors first, most instructors tend to forget that they were once students. They get out there and they start driving the students, doing all kinds of stuff, beating up on the students, doing this to the students, doing that to the students. The whole idea of training is to pass on what you have accumulated, what you have accomplished. All there is now. Tomorrow doesn't exist. Yesterday is gone. All you have is the eternal present. So do the best that you can with those students that you bring up and give them everything that you have. Hold back nothing. Now, of course, you can't give them everything at once. You have to give it to them as they can handle it, as they can tolerate it.
Yes, sir.
A baby can't eat steak.
Yes, sir.
So that's what you have to worry about. For beginners coming in, recognize that this is a path. The martial arts dojo training mat is a microcosm of life itself. When you walk in, put your uniform on, step to the edge of the mat, kneel down, bow in, transform your thinking from the mundane things that you were going through out there in the streets or at home or what happened yesterday to the task at hand. The task at hand is to become a bigger, better you. And if you don't aspire to do that, choose another endeavor because martial arts is not for you. You don't dabble at the martial arts. It's not a plaything. You're learning to be able to defend yourself, but you first have to get to know yourself. And that's what martial arts training is all about, to discover who you are, starting from the inside out. Self-defense doesn't start out here. Learning how to beat somebody up, or block a kick, or block a punch. Self-defense starts inside yourself by eating the right foods, taking care of this, because this is the only transportation that we have, and building this thing up. We are mind, body, spirit. Martial arts training helps you develop the spirit and the understanding so that you can merge those three together before it's time for the spirit to drop the body.
Wow. Beautiful. Beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful. So with that, sir, I say, us. Thank you. Thank you, us. Thank you very much.